Hello, every this song, dude. Listen to this. It's like Nintendo and Christmas, like, had a weird kid. Hello, episode 6 of Schozophronio, finally, this darn podcast, it's been so long, dang it, darn. I've been sick, excuse number one. I've been sick. Like, today, I woke up and I finally feel like my voice is back to where it was, where it should be, where it is, where it can be, where it will be, where it would be, where when it me when I mama. Whoops. And yeah, you know what? I just feel good again. I feel good, and I'm recording for the first time in forever. For the first time in forever. Anyways, I'm back and ready to scotes on the rest of the year. Just scotes through December. You know what I mean? Not really. I don't really know what scotes means as a verb like that. Not really sure. But in the meantime of all this stuff, you know what happened? You know what? Can you guess what happened? You know what? You know what? You know what? YouTube, the YouTube channel is up now. It's all caught up. Everything's all on there. All the font is good. I don't know why I said that way. Sharon did all of that, actually. I appreciate her sharing her skills with me. I'm an idiot. But yeah, YouTube is caught up. Caught up like Usher, you know what I mean? It's all up there. I think episode 3, I mean, just to point it out, because that's the only time where I recorded one with a video. Episode 3, I think, is you can get a look into what my closet looks like. Just throwing that out there. I'm not videoing? Recording this one via video. I don't know why. I think I could do that, actually. Well, it's too late now. but yeah, the YouTube channel will be where, like, where videos go, as YouTube is usually where videos are, mostly. I'm stoked about it because I now have a place to where I can upload a video for when I go to Legoland. I did take up the Cyber Monday, which is the last time I sent out an episode, which, dude, get it together. That's the last, yeah, I bought friggin' Legoland tickets, so that will be documented and up there. I think it's like February to March is my window to go, so Schozophronio hits up Legos, dude. That's when that's gonna happen. I'm actually really stoked about that. Like, Legoland, I don't know, I kind of know what to expect. I, like, watched some videos around that time where I bought the tickets. Some videos. But I don't want to, like, spoil it. But I don't know. If you've been to Legoland within the past, like, year, let me know. Because I'd like to hear more about it. I mean, I'm going to go next year. Which is cool how Schozophronio has created this thing. I looked up, like, me going to Legoland next year came up out of this, podcast, which is like, I don't know why I find that so cool, but like, it's Schozophronio has its own like little thing that it's doing for my own life, and I think that's dope, you know. Anyways, that's next year. So YouTube's up. Check it out. Subscribe to it. Whatever. Yeah, it's there. Speaking of Christmas, that intro song, what I did was I Googled obnoxious Christmas song, and through, in a trail of clicks on my computer, it led me down the road of chiptune Christmas songs, and I landed on that one. And there's another one I'll probably use for the outro of this episode. Incredible. Incredible to hear. Hold on. I promise I'm not sick anymore. That's the first time I've sneezed on this podcast, I think. Schozophronio, episode 6. Return of the Jedi. What was I saying, dude? That sneeze, like, shook my brain. Or maybe it's the coffee. Both. Obnoxious Christmas songs. So I land on chiptune thing. Ridiculous. It's nice to hear the product of Nintendo, like, what Nintendo and Christmas, you know, their offspring sounds like. And what bored people do with what they do musically. I think that's awesome. So there's that Christmas music, but there's also my favorite Christmas album, which I'll probably start now. And so this music comes from the album that is my favorite Christmas album, Charlie Brown Christmas. It's like the Christmas mood that I'm in. Like, it always fits the time of year for me, no matter what. Because I'm not, you know, like those crazy freaking Mariah Carey songs, dude. Like, and I will admit, I do have a guilty pleasure Christmas song, which is, in other news, I just have to say this real quick. My hair in the morning, I'm saying this because the shadow that my hair is casting from the light above onto the Snuggie to my right, the shadow that is casted, my hair in the morning always, never fails, always, looks like Tintin, dude. Look up Tintin. Google Tintin now. That sounded very demanding. Just, if you Google Tintin, his hair, that's what my hair looks like every morning. Every morning. There it is. Good morning, Chad. Tintin, there you are. I don't have a dog, though. A little white dog. I would love to have a little white dog. And know, like, this captain guy. Well, I don't know. I've seen Tintin, like, I saw the one where, like, Daniel Craig's in it. Like, in the animated one, and then I've seen some, like, comics or whatever they are, books. I look like that dude in the morning, every morning. My hair, a little, like, curl up in the front. My hair always looks like Tintin's in the morning. Anyways, Charlie Brown Christmas, the album is the best. It's the best Christmas album, hands down. Hands down. Why is it, do people say that because, like, if there's any objection, people are, like, putting their hands up, they're like, excuse me, is that what that is? I don't know why I'm just thinking about that now. Like, best Christmas album, no, put your hands down, is that what that is? I think so. I mean, it makes sense. It's just funny to visualize that. I don't know, I'm on a tangent. So Christmas, you know what I was thinking about the other day? Where do candy canes come from? Candy canes. Like, as I Google it, what's the deal with candy canes? I want to know. Like, where do they start? Did they start by hanging on a tree? Why are there so many flavors now? What's the deal? So, in the spirit of Christmas, let's look up what candy canes are all about. They're originally a German place of origin. No, I don't want to donate Wikipedia, you piece of... Candy cane is a cane-shaped stick candy often associated with Christmastide, as well as St. Nicholas Day. Doesn't it just Christmas? Christmastide and St. Nicholas Day. Traditionally red and white stripes and flavored with peppermint, but may also be a variety of flavors and colors. Alternative names for the candy cane: Santa's cane or peppermint stick. Cool. Okay, so according to Wikipedia, this section of the podcast brought to you by Wikipedia. According to folklore, in 1670 in Cologne, Germany, the choir master at Cologne Cathedral, wishing to remedy the noise caused by children in his church during tradition on Christmas Eve, asked a local candy maker for some sugar sticks for the kids making all the noise. In order to justify the practice of giving candy to children during worship services, he asked the candy maker to add a crook at the top of each stick, which would help children remember the shepherds who visited the infant Jesus. In addition, he used the white color, spelled with O-U-R at the end, so that's fancy. I'll hold my phone with my pinky out then. In addition, he used the white color of the converted sticks to teach children about the Christian belief in the sinless life of Jesus. From Germany, candy canes spread to other parts of Europe, where they were handed out during plays reenacting the Nativity. As such, according to this legend, the candy cane became associated with Christmastide. Cool. Alright. Okay, this is the pop culture section of candy canes. Pop culture. American rock band The White Stripes released the song Candy Cane Children in 2002. Their Icky Thump, 2007, also mentions the candy cane. Member Jack White has expressed the band's fondness of peppermints and the color scheme of red and white in interviews. Why do we need to know about that? Why did my Snuggie just fall down, damn it? Why does this happen? How did that happen? I wasn't even touching it. Is someone sabotaging the podcast right now? Maybe there's a closet ghost that, like, is like, shut up already. Here's the door. And he, like, moved the Snuggie. Like, all right, enough of your bantering. Get out. I don't know why it's a British ghost, but... What if there's actually... Now I'm thinking there's an actual ghost in my closet. That would be the worst. Why do I give a shit what the White Stripes think about... Jack White has expressed the band's fondness of peppermints and the color scheme, which is red and white. Come on. Wikipedia, you're a joke. Okay, so some German church guy was like, kid, shut up. Yo, can you make some peppermint candies? Parents, don't worry. They're shepherds. Jesus, you know, it's a shepherd stick that they're eating. Remember the shepherds met with the Jesus, you know? It's okay. It may be sugar, but remember the shepherds. And yeah, the white color on there, it's because Jesus lives with no sins. Just shut your kids up, please. Thanks. Which is essentially, okay, that's cool. And thus, the candy cane was born. Very interesting. What other tidbits are there here? The earliest verifiable reference to stick candy is a record of the 1837 exhibition of Massachusetts Charitable Mechanic Association, where confections were judged competitively. A recipe for straight peppermint candy sticks, white with colored stripes, was published in 1844. The candy cane is found in literature in 1866, though no description of color or flavor was provided. Its earliest known association with Christmas was in 1874, and by 1882, canes were being hung on Christmas trees. That's cool. Okay. Very good. And then, like, production stuff. Like, whatever. Who cares? Very interesting. Okay, so now you know about candy canes, dude. That's kind of cool. Also, you know what? As I'm looking up shit on the Google, as I do very all too often, this week I mentioned to somebody, I was like, oh, sorry, I was eavesdropping on your conversation. And I was immediately corrected with, did you just say eavesdropping? And I was like, yeah. I'm like, it's eavesdropping. So I thought, bitch. No, it's not. It's eavesdropping with a V. I was like, no, it's eavesdropping. Like, no, it's eavesdropping. I was like, all right, well, that's not okay. And I just kind of like shrugged it off, like, whatever. I don't make time for stupid, you know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? If you're stupid, I don't got time for you, you know? So I haven't looked it up yet. So, you know what? Eavesdropping. Where does that come from? Because there has to be like an origin story to that. Like, where can we, what is eavesdropping? Search financial security. What the fuck? Thesaurus? No. Word detective. Dear word detective. Oh, so this is like a... Dear word detective. Lately, I have pondered the origins of the word eavesdropping. My guess is that it came from around... Whoops, there's no word from there. My guess is that it came around after too many people fell from the eaves of their houses while attempting to listen in on the conversations being held in the room below. Now, I am sure this is not entirely accurate, so perhaps you could explain the more correct, but most likely not as amusing, origins? Robin Smith. So, Robin is writing the word detective? That's how this website works? Oh, I don't know about that, said the word detective. What? Okay, let's just cliff notes this. Okay, so the eaves. Okay, so the eaves of a house or building are the parts of the roof that extend beyond the walls of the structure. I guess I had to remember that. I had to account for those as I was building my gingerbread house this past month, I guess. It was a while ago, a couple weeks ago. Because the roof pieces, as I had the front where the door was and the back where like the window was, and then the side pieces and the roof pieces were like too big. I was like, what's the deal here? But if they met at the peak of the roof, I had to account for eaves hanging off. That's cool that I have words for that. So next time when you're building your next time, or if you plan on building gingerbread houses this season, account for the eaves if your roof pieces are too big. That's why your roof pieces are too big, because of the eaves. Anyway, I digress. Moving on. The purpose of eaves in the days before gutters were common was to carry rainwater away from the foundation of the house. Whereas any homeowner knows, it can play all sorts of mischief with the structural integrity of the building. The use of eaves in building houses is ancient, and by an equally ancient custom, houses could not be built within 2 feet of a property line, lest the rainwater shed from the eaves cause problems for a neighbor. So, human nature being what it is, snoops quickly discovered that if they wished to find out what their neighbors were up to, the eavesdrop, where the water was accounted, like the space between houses where water was accounted for so it doesn't affect the structural integrity of the house itself, the eavesdrop near an open window was the place to stand and listen. Thus, by the early 1600s, to eavesdrop meant to stand in the eavesdrop of a house to hear conversations within, and more generally, to listen to private conversations by any means. So, now you know where eavesdrop came from. I do a lot of that in this podcast, where if I'm corrected on something where I don't know exactly, but I know, like, I don't know what eavesdrop means, but I know it's not eavesdrop. That happens a lot to me, where just like sayings in general are said, and I say them correct, like burning bridges. I remember one time I was sitting with a group of people after work a while ago, like a long time ago, a couple years. And this dude was like, well, yeah, but I mean, I would, you know, I want to look for another job, but I don't really want to burn any britches. And I thought he just said bridges, like, I don't want to burn any britches. But no, he was literally talking about, like, I was like, wait, burn any, like, liar, liar, pants on fire? Like, burning any britches? Like, burn your britches? Like, your pants? He's like, yeah, I don't want to burn any britches. And that's not the saying. It's burning bridges. You don't want to burn bridges. He's like, oh, it's bridges? I was like, dude, you're a 25-year-old man. Yes, it's burning bridges. So, like, and I don't know where that came from. I just know the saying. I just know what the saying is. Don't burn bridges. Don't burn your britches either, I guess. Because otherwise you're a liar, right? Because of the pants on fire thing. But that's all I'm trying to say. I know it's eavesdrop. So don't tell me it's eavesdrop. But now you and I, we all know where it came from. According to the word detective. But that sounds pretty legit. I mean, it's reasonable. It's a reasonable explanation. So, yeah. So now we know where the candy cane came from. Candy cane came from. And now we know where eavesdrop came from. That was just like, I just had to do that for myself. And now you know. You're welcome. Now the ghost in my closet knows. You're welcome, ghost. Don't move my Snuggie anymore, please. And yeah, so I mean, moving along with this episode. Okay, so candy cane. What else? Dinosaur of the day. You know what? I was thinking about dinosaur of the Our dinosaur of the day made me think even more so than usual how ridiculous this whole dinosaur thing is. And maybe I might just power through the alphabet and just end it there at Z. But I don't know. Okay, so dinosaur of the day this week, this day, Monday, is of course the drinker. Named after American paleontologist Edward Drinker Cope. This is the name of a dinosaur. Drinker. It was found in the swamps of North Africa from the late Jurassic period, so 155 to 145 million years ago. It was about 6 feet long, stood on two legs with like two, you know, like the two bigger legs, and then had like the little dinky arms as dinosaurs do. Dinky arms. Those dinky arms that dinos have. 6 feet long and about 25 to 50 pounds, so it's a little guy, a little dinosaur. Small size, flexible tail, and complex tooth structure, which is ironic because it's called the drinker. Ate plants, and so so it was named after Edward Drinker Cope, whose infamous bone wars with rival Othniel Marsh, which we did, I believe we did reference that in the Albertosaurus episode, when we had the first dino of the day. As I say those words in that order, I have the Albertosaurus episode where we discuss the bone wars between Othniel Marsh and Edward Drinker Cope. What the hell? What have I made? It produced so the drinker produced many dinosaur fossils, which are world famous today, which described it was described as a probable close relative of the Othniellia named for Marsh. So this guy, these bone wars were so hard for each other. This bone wars was going so hard that Drinker found these bones and he's like, these are drinker bones. I'm gonna call this one Drinker because Othniel Marsh found bones, very similar bones. And he already named them the Othniellia. Like, that was the dinosaur. So these raging bone wars were going on so hard that he was like, no, this is this dinosaur. And like, well, I already named that dinosaur. So the bones that you found, Mr. Drinker, your Drinker dinosaur, that's the Othniellia that's already been found. I don't get it, man. So that's the Drinker. And if I had a video thing, I'd show the drinker. Maybe I'll sketch it up. Maybe that. Whoops. Maybe that's what I'll do. And I think it's funny that he named the, so Drinker named. So Drinker named this dinosaur Drinker that he found in the swamps of North Africa. And they're similar to Othniel Marsh. And when you think Marsh, isn't marsh like a swampy area? Isn't that a thing? Like marsh? Isn't that, is that safe to say? I need to look that up real quick. Is it Yeah, like a wetland that is dominated by herbaceous rather than woody plant species. I just think that's funny. Is that? I don't know. Maybe not. I don't know. Anywho, dinosaur of the day, a freaking drinker. So as I was thinking about the whole dino thing and how more and more ridiculous it's getting, I kind of want to talk about something, and I'm just going to power through the alphabet, like I said. I want to talk about cheese, dude. Because that's one thing besides sports and video games that I know about is cheese. And that's my life, so, well, my life is video games, sports, and cheese. I guess if you know me, you know that. But cheese is actually one thing that I kind of know about, like, more than most people, I would say, because I worked with cheese when I worked at Whole Foods for like a year and a half, almost 2 years. And so I think it would be more applicable for the listener if I could like have a cheese, talk about it, like tasting stuff about it, and then you go and you try it and you're like, dude, tried the cheese of the week. Hell yeah, that was good. Can't wait to hear about the next one where I can actually apply this information to my own life and enjoy some cheese at the same time. Instead of, yeah, dinosaur of the day, that's cool. What's it called, the drinker? What the hell am I supposed to do with this information? I don't know. I'm kind of making fun of myself right now. A little bit, but now I know there's an Albertosaurus, Albertoceratops, a drinker, there's a T-Rex, there's a pterodactyl, there's a roller coaster at Legoland, the Coastersaurus. Like, this is all rando info, bro. But I think knowing about a cheese would be a little more useful and enjoyable. So maybe I go off and on with the dino of the day. I'm just thinking out loud here. Just thinking out loud. But yeah, let me know. Let me know if you want to know more about cheese, and I'll throw it in like some episodes. I think that'll be pretty legit. Yeah. I mean, that sounds like a no-brainer almost, but let me know. I don't want to do it if you're digging the dino of the day. Dang it. Let me know. But yeah, I think I'm stoked. So I'm stoked about the YouTube channel. I'm glad that that's up. one thing that I was working on, I mean, I don't know. I was working on an episode while I was sick for a while, and it's going to be an interview. It's going to be an interview. With a good friend that I that I've made over the past couple weeks. So I'm looking forward to episodes in the future where I can have, you know, guests on and just talk about, you know, their life experiences, that kind of thing. I think the future, at least by year's end, sounds like a pirates movie. At world's end, that's what it is. Schozophronio by year's end. I'm planning on having a guest for the Christmas special, whatever that looks like. I'm still like planning what that looks like. And how that works. I haven't even tried to have a second mic hooked up. So, I'm looking forward to what that looks like, how that's going to turn out, and, kind of what I can do with it. Because I do want a Christmas special, and if there's something that that you think we should talk about on the Christmas special, just like, I mean, there's like general Christmas things, maybe like traditions that we have or whatever, like general Christmassy talks. But I'm stoked for it, especially because Christmas comes out on a Monday. I usually, what I want to have happen with this podcast is Monday releases, which has, it's been, because I was sick, I don't know if that's an excuse either, but, you know what, think, speaking of excuses, I always, it makes me think of the War of Art book. That's how I'm going to transition that. I mean, I have it here. I was looking at it this morning, or, you know, I look at it occasionally throughout my week. And I found one that, like, I was flipping through and I saw the word sick and I was like, oh, I've been sick. This book is about, you know, whatever. So I'm just going to read. And I know how much people like me reading because I'm one of the best readers in this closet. I can't read very well out loud. I can read fairly well in my head. I think we all can. But as soon as I go to read it out loud and stuff, something happens where I get crossed up. I don't know. I'm trying to explain an excuse for my lack of reading skills, but whatever. Page 27, The War of Art. Let's just jump into this thing. So it's called Resistance and Victimhood. Doctors estimate that 70 to 80% of their business is non-health related. People aren't sick, they're self-dramatizing. Sometimes the hardest part of a medical job is keeping a straight face. As Jerry Seinfeld observed in his 20 years of dating, that's a lot of acting fascinated. The acquisition of a condition lends significance to one's existence.
What?
Let me read that again. The acquisition of a condition lends significance to one's existence. An illness, a cross to bear. Some people go from condition to condition. They cure one, and another one pops up to take its place. The condition becomes a work of art in itself, a shadow version of the real creative act the person is avoiding by expending so much care cultivating his condition. A victim act is a form of passive aggression. It seeks to achieve gratification not by honest work or a contribution made of... God, <I'm...
laughs> could you tell that I was struggling? I can't read!
A victim act is a form of passive aggression. It seeks to achieve gratification not by honest work or a contribution made of, out of... I so wish I could edit this shit out, but I'm not going to. Okay. Third time is a gosh darn charm. A victim act is a form of passive aggression. It seeks to achieve gratification not by honest work or a contribution made out of one's experience or insight or love, but by the manipulation of others through silent and not so silent threat. The victim compels others to come to his rescue or to behave as he wishes by holding them hostage to the prospect of his own further illness, meltdown, mental dissolution, or simply by threatening to make their lives so miserable that they do what he wants. Casting yourself as a victim is the antithesis of doing your work. Don't do it. If you're doing it, stop.
Oy vey. Okay.
So, initial thoughts, I can't freaking read. I think this was kind of true. I can relate to this because the past, like, week or so, where I was like, yeah, I'm sick, so, I don't know. Like, maybe I'll just, like, do some research for an episode that I'm, like the next episode that I have. So as I'm doing the research, I'm kind of getting distracted, and then I, like, well, I don't feel so well, so, like, my head hurts, so I can't do this right now. And then I, like, start watching a movie, and then now I'm watching a movie, and, like, well, I ate too much candy while I was watching a movie, and I shouldn't eat so much candy while I was watching the movie, and now I'm, like, even more sick, and my voice is completely shot now, so now I can't record anything at all, and, like, my head hurts for, like, researching stuff, and then dragging other people into it, like, well, I can't do that because I'm sick, and then I just, it's this whole snowball thing to where my chain of excuses become a work of art itself, where it's like, wow, you constructed quite the web there of excuses. That is quite the piece of work there. Where I think I do that a lot, whether I'm sick or not. And I think we all know, I'm definitely not one. We all know hypochondriacs, where it's like, well, so I have these symptoms, so this means I have brain cancer. So now, well, since I'm dying, I can't do what I want to do. I need to get my shift covered because I found out I have brain cancer because I have headaches at this time of day, the past couple days. Like, what? That's an extreme case of nothing. I mean, not to downplay any, you know, if you feel symptoms, you can look them up, but don't be dramatic with it, you know? Like, it's frustrating if you're not a hypochondriac and you know of one, and all they do is tell you their symptoms all the time, and they're like, yeah, so I think I have this. And you, like, every week it's a different thing. I've known a couple of those people throughout my life, and it's just like, dude, WebMD needs to, like, you need to block WebMD from your search, from your Google thing. Like, it's not helping you at all. Anyways, I think that was just a good one for me to read, because I'm constantly making excuses why I can't do stuff, and especially when I'm sick. And, like, I just make up this web of excuses why I'm not doing what I should be doing, in quotes. Because even though I was sick, I could still do stuff to contribute to, like, what schizophrenia is. It was cool that the YouTube stuff went up in the meantime, so I'm glad that, like, that kind of opened the window for that to happen in a way. And I was thinking about it. I could have done the podcast for the deaf, where I could have just, like, turned my microphone on in my closet for, like, an hour and just released that. Which I think, I mean, it's going to happen eventually, slated for 2018. So for all you deafs out there, you got your episode dedicated to you coming 2018, dude. Look forward to it, bros. But yeah, I think I'm gonna go ahead and, like, end this here. I always mention that, and I always have that stupid, what is that laugh that I do? What the hell? It's when I say something dumb and like, it's like some stupid noise comes out. I don't like it. Whatever, it happens. But yeah, there is the again. So let's do a little recap. Let's throw some music, some recap music on, shall we? Recap music. Fade in now. So, this week on Schozophronio, we learned that candy canes come from Germany, and some German church guy wanted the kids to shut up during the service, so he gave them sugar sticks. Kind of had the sugar guy curve him a little bit, like, yo, you know, it's a sugar stick, but it's okay because, you know, remember the shepherds? Yeah, and the white on those, Jesus was sinless. So, parents, shut your mouth, shut your kids up, everyone shut up, please. That's all that German guy wanted. He wanted everybody in the church to shut up. Like, hey, parents, shut up, it's okay, it's just a sugar cane stick. Shut up, kids, eat your sugar cane sticks. Shut up, parents, shut up, kids. Thank you. Go on with the service. We also learned about the drinker dinosaur. That was named by some stubborn, raging bone war guy. And, it's a little dinosaur, little two leg, two little dinky arms, from the late Jurassic period. Dinosaur of the day, drinker. Also learned eavesdropping, where that came from. It's not eavesdropping. There is a V in there. And also, yeah, that's it. Learned what my favorite Christmas album is. So, yeah, I think that'll do it for, you know, Schozophronio episode 7, 6? 6. I don't know anymore. But yeah, subscribe to the YouTube thing. iTunes is still going on. It's on the Google Play thing. Yeah, dude. It's like, it's still on Spreaker. That's where it's like uploading to. And then, look out during the week. I'm looking to get a Scotes on the Go episode. Whatever that looks like. And maybe even like a video for YouTube, because that's a thing now. And that's where videos go. So, yeah. Hope y'all have a good week. Yeah, man. Thanks for listening. Thanks for your time, as always. Yeah, you have yourself a swell Monday and the rest of the week. And, yeah. Let me know if you wanna learn about cheese. I'm down to do that. I just don't want to add too many things onto this. Whatever. I don't want to have like a dinosaur thing and then like a cheese thing. It's like, should I do it after the dinosaurs or should I just drop the dinosaur thing? It's getting more and more ridiculous. So, anyways, let me know. Okay, love you.